were looking at transmitter circuits, and I mentioned that this current mode transmitter is one of the widely used ones for high speed communications. The terminations are well controlled, you will have physical resistors on either side, and there is a case for maybe on the transmit side slightly increasing the resistance so that it is not terminated perfectly at DC, but at higher frequencies it is better because the devices become smaller. Okay. Now, there are a few options. First of all, I will assume that there is a differential transmission line. Okay. And here we have R, and the characteristic impedance is R, and these are also terminated like that. Okay. And I will show the current drive in an abstract way like this. Sorry, this is a current drive. Maybe you can show it like this. And the received voltage is here. Okay. The S and S bar denote switches which send the bits. Now, let us say I want the receive voltage to be plus or minus V p. Okay. And so, I want this to be plus or minus V p, I mean corresponding to basically 1 and 0 symbols. So, what is the value of I you need? We want a certain amplitude at the receiver. Okay. The received signal is the differential signal, and I want that to be either plus Vp or minus Vp corresponding to when S equals 1 or S bar equals 1. So, let me know, I mean calculate what is the, what the value of I is that you have to switch. Vp divided by R by 2. Okay. Yeah. Huh? So, if this switch is open, this side will be 0. Okay. The other side has to be Vp to get plus Vp. And similarly, if this switch is open, S is open, this is 0 and this has to be Vp. Okay. So, if this is Vp, this is also Vp. So, it is Vp divided by R by 2. Okay. So, that is the current, or 2 Vp divided by R. Okay. Now, every transmitter, I mean all our circuits are biased from a fixed supply voltage, right? I mean we have a voltage that supplies power to the IC. So, we have some VDD and we need some circuit that supplies this current. Okay. So, essentially we look at how much current has to be supplied, and in the best case that will be the current that is drawn from the power supply. Okay. So, that gives an indication of power dissipation. Now, let us say I do not have to connect it like this, this is a differential transmission line. I could terminate it differentially, right. Let us say this is a differential transmission line and I terminate it differentially in 2R. Okay. And again my received signal is this. I want this to be plus minus Vp. What is the value of I in this case? Huh? still the same. How do you conclude that? I into 2R will be equal to B, but I is not necessarily going through 2R, right? So, if the switch S is on, how much current is going here and how much current is going there? I by 3. Yeah. So, I by 4 will flow through 2R. So, I by 4 times 2R should be equal to Vp. So, what is I? It is again 2 Vp by R. It turns out to be the same. The voltages at different terminals are not the same, but it is exactly the same. So, sometimes you do use differential termination. This is so that common mode currents do not flow this way. Okay. So, this is essentially you need a transmitter which can switch this much current in order to get a certain amount of received signal voltage. Okay. So, now let us look at the alternative. Earlier on I said that you can at the basic network level there is no difference whether you have current mode signaling or voltage mode signaling. Instead of current source and resistor in parallel, you will have a voltage source and resistor in series. Okay. So, this voltage will have to change polarity. Or maybe let me first show it like this. Again, I want Vrx to be plus minus Vp. Okay. So, what would I be transmitting here and there? Let us say Vrx, I want it to be plus Vp. So, what should be Vs and Vs prime, or what is one possibility which is the most obvious then? So, Vs must be 2 Vp. And Vs prime must be 0, right? And how much current is flowing through this? Vp by R. Okay. And if you need minus Vp here, this will be 2 Vp and this will be 0. Okay. So, in fact, you can think of it as a source of two Vp, which is connected to either side, right? It is exactly the same. Okay. And how much current is this required to supply? So, in the transmitter, there is a voltage source and it has to supply a current of Vp by R, right? So it is less than in the current mode signaling, that is the basic point. Now, one thing you have to understand is like if it is nice to show ideal sources like this, it is not quite correct to calculate how much power is being delivered from that, because we do not have arbitrary voltage sources and current sources. We have a supply voltage of VDD and we have to, whatever circuit we make will draw power from VDD, right. So, the picture is always like this. There will be some circuit that is powered by VDD and this supplies a certain amount of current, okay. And roughly I can say that the minimum current I need to draw from VDD will be I, right. That is sort of the class AB case, okay. So, that is why I am looking at only the current that is being driven from the transmitter, because that will eventually get drawn from the supply of the transmitter, okay. So, the fact that the voltage is higher, it does not matter, okay. It may mean that with a given supply you cannot create this voltage, that is possible. If VP is too high, you may not be able to. If you want VP of 1 volt with transmitter supply of 1 volt, you may not be able to create it, because you need a you need to generate a voltage of 2 volts here, okay. But that is a different thing. Assuming that it is possible, what is relevant is the current drawn in the transmitter. Is it okay? Now, let me consider the other case. Sorry, differentially terminated case. So, again, if this VRX has to be equal to VP, what would you set this to? Now, what should be VS and VS prime? If we want VRX to be VP, this VP is across 2R. So, I need to have 2VP here and 0 there, okay. That is fine, right. I mean across this I will have VP, and then similarly if I need minus VP, I need to have 2VP here and 0 there. And what is the current in the transmitter? VP by 2R, okay. So, the transmitter looks, can look similar to this. You can have this VS and VS prime, which generate either 2VP or 0. Actually, I think even here that is a better thing than showing the switches like that. Open switches are not the correct thing to show. Okay. When it is terminated on each side separately, it is okay. If you have 0 here, 0 current here, it will have 0 voltage, but I think this is a more appropriate picture. The transmitter side, the voltage source should go to 0 if it is 0 volts, okay. So, now if you have a differentially terminated receiver and you have a voltage termination, the current is actually 1/4 of what you see with the current mode transmitter, okay. Again, like I said, it is because we always take the because the transmitter is always powered from a fixed supply voltage. It is the current that you try to source that matters, assuming you are able to create the voltage, okay. So, that is why you can see that there is some motivation to go to voltage mode transmitters, okay. This is of course in the absolutely ideal case. This is equal to 1/4 the current with current mode Tx and any kind of termination, the current mode transmitter has the same current, right? Of what? Yeah. That's correct. But what I am saying is, it's not this current into this voltage that matters. That will be the same, right? Like to generate a certain amount of signal. So, if you, in this case, you have 2 times Vp by R times I, right? I mean, that will be that will be the same, I think, in every case, okay? But like I said, what matters is this current source is not a current source like this. You do not have a current source that is available. What you have is, you have a transmitter that is supplied by some fixed voltage VDD, and this output has to supply a given current, okay? So, what matters is this supply voltage times the current. That is the best case, okay? If you want a circuit that delivers a certain amount of current, the bias current, the current drawn from the supply will be typically higher, right? But let us say it is the most efficient thing, and we draw a current which is exactly equal to the current that you are trying to supply. So, then the power dissipation is the supply voltage times the current that you are driving. So, that is why I said I am only looking at the amount of current that is being driven, okay? Yeah, it is true, because for instance, the voltage swing here in a current mode transmitter will be smaller than the voltage swing that is required here, okay? Because in a current mode transmitter, the current gets divided. So, the swing will be the same as on the receiver side, whereas the current will be twice as much as on the receiver side. In a voltage mode transmitter, it is the opposite. The voltage will be twice as much as on the receiver side, but the current will be the same throughout, okay? But that does not take into account the fact that the transmitter is powered by some fixed voltage VDD, okay? Now, the other point of current versus voltage is basically, with a current mode transmitter, you may be able to generate a higher swing, because with a voltage mode transmitter, you need twice that much swing at the transmitter, and you may not have enough room within the power supply, that is possible. But again, now in a serial link, we are talking about hundreds of millivolts of swing. So, let us assume that all of these are possible, okay? Now, how do you make a voltage mode transmitter? It turns out it is a little more complicated. It is done. I mean, it is actually routinely done, mainly because this 1/4 of power consumption is extremely attractive, right? 1/4 of current consumption. Practice, if you take everything into account, you will probably still get, you can probably still get about 50% saving in the current, which is still a big deal, okay? Now, how would you make a voltage mode transmitter? How do you make a voltage switch? First of all, the essentially you need to have a voltage source. Voltage source meaning it has no internal resistance, and you should connect switches like this. Okay, if you do this, what happens is, if S is 1, the output voltage will be equal to the voltage source, and if S is 0, it will be equal to the 0. Okay, in this case, the resistance looking back will also be 0, and you can connect a resistance in series to form the termination resistance. Okay, now what is the structure that looks like this? Sir? No, I mean a transistor level circuit that, yeah, not a transmission gate. First of all, let us say that you use the supply voltage itself as a voltage source, okay? Then for this, this has to switch to a high level. So, you use a PMOS transistor and this has to switch to a low level. So, it is a NMOS transistor. So, you can use an inverter itself, okay. And possibly you can have separate drives to avoid this shorting current and things like that. I will not go into that, but this is a possibility, right. Sometimes what you do is, like if there is a lot of current here, these are not connected together, because when the input voltage is in the middle, these two are kind of on and then there is a lot of short circuit current. So, then you have separate drives which have some non-overlap, so that the two are not simultaneously on. But okay, let us say in a serial link, we want to keep things simple, this is like that, okay. Now, if you do this, what is the resistance looking back? Yeah. No, not parallel, because it will be either in one of the two states. So, depending on whether it is 1 or 0, you will have either RDSP or RDSN. Okay. This is for output high and this is for output low. Okay. Now, of course, these are like very poorly controlled quantities, right. Poorly controlled meaning they depend on first of all the supply voltage itself and then temperature and process and everything, okay. So, how might you be able to fix this? R on, yeah, meaning this is RDSP and RDSN in the triode region, okay. So, maybe I should write it as because obviously, when this is high, this is supposed to be in the, I mean, this will be in the triode region. I expect it to be in the triode region, okay. So, how do you fix this? We need, I mean, in a serial link transmitter, high speed serial link, we need better control of the impedance than this. So, what are all the possibilities? In fact, look at the picture above, like what is it that you could do? Many possibilities. One is of course, just to try and copy this picture. In this case, the switch has zero resistance and you just connect a resistance in series, right. So, you could try to do that. That is, if this is the case, of course, I mean you have nearly ideal switches and it will in principle work. Okay, the problem here is that this R first of all is not large to begin with, it is 50 ohms. So, to get those R on P and N to be like much smaller than that, you have to use very large devices. So, you will end up with large parasitics. Now, if you have large parasitic capacitances here, this also, I mean everything is a part of the channel, right. I mean this also creates ISI and things like that. So, and as I compromise, you can make it, I mean this much less than is a little bit vague, right. We can make it 1/10 or 1/5 even, okay. And then you adjust the value of R, so that it the total resistance equals the desired termination resistance, okay. So this people have done, or maybe with a little bit of variation, you connect separate resistances with the N and P sides, so that this plus the PMOS resistance gives you the termination resistance, this plus NMOS gives you termination resistance. Okay. But I mean using trying to size the devices so that their on resistance is much smaller than R under all PVT, this is not the preferred way because it just is too much of overhead. Okay. So, one possibility is to use devices in parallel like he suggested, and then have some control loop. You can have a sort of low frequency control loop on the side which detects what the resistance is. Okay. You have multiple devices in parallel and you activate as many as required for correct termination. Okay. That is what you may do is you have these units, okay, and all these are in parallel, okay, you have many of them. What you do is, I mean, to turn on a certain number of NMOS, you provide this drive signal, this is the transmit signal, right? You provide it to only as many as you need. Okay. And similarly, I am showing N and P separately because the number of PMOS and number of NMOS may be different for a given termination resistance. The number of PMOS transistors and number of NMOS transistors may be different. So, you drive them separately and this drive signal itself would be disabled so that only a certain number of them turn on. Okay. Get the idea, right? So, again I am not writing like every possible variant of this and so on, but each now you design each one. So, maybe let us say you have each one to nominally have let us say 1 kilo ohm of on resistance and you have 20 or 30 of them. Okay. Over PVT this 1 kilo ohm may vary from 800 ohms to or maybe even more like 600 ohms to 1.5 kilo ohms and so on. Okay. And then you connect as many as are required to get the desired termination resistance. Okay. And how do you know whether it is the desired termination resistance? You can use a feedback loop. For instance, so let us say you are allowed to have one external resistance for the whole chip. Okay. So then you pass a current, reference current through it, and you can pass the same reference current, I mean, and you can always have scaling and so on in these things, right, to some internal resistance. Okay. And you compare these voltages and you vary the internal resistance until it becomes equal to the external resistance, and this can be IRF times alpha and this is Rn by alpha. Okay. And also I show it as though it is a continuously varying resistor or a potentiometer, but it can be anything. This whole loop, this can also be digitally controlled. That is, you have a digitally controlled resistor, meaning you have a number of series segments or parallel segments and you connect the right number of them, and this basically then you have a comparator between these two. Depending on the polarity of that, you change the configuration of the switches. Okay. It does not have to be an op amp which is doing this. This is okay. Again, I am not drawing like every little detail of it, but the main point is to understand the principle. Okay. So, you have a reference current, you pass it through the external resistor, you pass it through the internal resistor and compare the voltages. That gives you a measure of whether the internal, that gives you an idea whether the internal resistance is smaller or bigger than what you want. So, then you can adjust it, whether it is digitally controlled, analog controlled, however it is, you can do that. This is okay. Now, once you have one resistor on chip which is controlled to the right value, you can create multiple copies of them, right. So, you use the same unit and then have the same control going to them. That is the business of exploiting matching on an IC, right. So, now the idea is this resistor will have the same value as that, and you can use this as a reference for something else also. Okay. For instance, now in this particular case, we need two control loops, one to set the resistance of the NMOS side and one to set the resistance of the PMOS side. Okay. So, again what you do is, I mean this resistance does not have to be a physical, I mean polysilicon resistance like this, it can also be a MOS, right. So, you have a number of MOS transistors and this is a digitally switched resistor. So, depending on how many you connect, the resistance from here to ground will vary and you can have your control loop, right. So, and you need one for NMOS and one for PMOS, and everything can be done with a single external resistance. Once you have a single external resistance, you can basically set all the internal resistances to the right value. Okay. And there are so many ways you can think of, I mean if you have different types of resistances, you can even time share this feedback loop, right. The external resistances does not have to be always connected to one particular feedback loop. You can use it in different time slots for different things, because this, it is assumed that once you set it, it does not change immediately, right. It drifts to temperature perhaps, but it is not going to change immediately. Is this okay? So, there are so many ways of setting this. So, you can do this. Okay. And a variant of this is to the MOS resistance, right, whatever you say, it will be nonlinear, right. It is not actually a linear resistance. So, you could try and improve it by having some linear resistance in combination with the on resistance. It will be more linear than just the MOS resistance, but again in this case the device size have to be larger than in the other case. Okay. So, that means parasitics are higher, etcetera, etcetera. The parasitics matter for two reasons. You have parasitics here. So, that means that when you switch from this side, not all of the current directly goes there, that is one effect. And then also this device is bigger. So, that means that you have to spend more power driving it. So, switching losses in the transmitter will be higher and so on. Is this okay? So, this is one possibility. The other possibility is to try and do what Aswini suggested, which is in these cases, these NMOS and PMOS transistors are fully turned on and off, meaning the gate is connected either to VDD or ground. We do not have to do that. So, let us say this is driven by an inverter. This does not have to be the full supply. Okay. So, this is some V drive, let us say, and what is that? I have to adjust this V drive so that the on resistance of this is whatever I want. I can do that, right. I mean basically I size this transistor such that if this is connected to VDD, the resistance will definitely be less than what I want. So, I can connect it to some slightly lower voltage and get the resistance that I want, and this V drive again has to be derived from a feedback loop. Okay. So, again I can do this. I have a reference resistance, it goes here, and the same, sorry, I have a reference current, and the same reference current I drive it into this as well. And you can imagine that there is some feedback loop that can drive this V drive. So, this has to be on. So, this has to be on, the transistor has to be on. So, it sets V drive such that non resistance of this equals the reference resistance. Okay. Again, you can do it for PMOS and NMOS and so on separately, because PMOS and NMOS anyway they do not track each other. This way you won't have parallel connections of devices, which is sometimes advantageous, because when you split a device into parallel devices, you will likely increase the parasitic capacitance, okay, because you have to connect multiple units in parallel and you have to separate the input drivers and so on. So, there may be a slight advantage. On the other hand, V drive is smaller, so that means that this is not as strongly on and it may be more nonlinear than the other one, okay. Full rail voltage where? No, no, Vp is not equal to Vdd. Yeah, you have to choose Vp, okay. So, in this case I showed it like this, okay. So, this point will get switched to whatever this voltage is, okay. If that is Vdd, it will be equal to Vdd with a resistance in series, but this should be the 2Vp value, right. So, if this 2Vp is different from Vdd, you have to also generate the supply from Vdd. Is this okay? Initially, I did not talk about it, but this is the 2Vp supply. This itself may have to be generated from Vdd using a regulator. So, depending on the swing that you want, you will have to do this. No, no, it should be the, I mean, we are assuming doubly terminated lines, it should be the same as, yeah, it should be 50 ohms, okay. Because the doubly terminated stuff gives you the best transmission characteristics. So, that is why it should be 50 ohms. That is why we are also putting all this effort to make the resistance accurate, not just mere much smaller than the something else, okay. So, if this 2Vp equals Vdd, you do not do anything. If it is less than Vdd, it is likely to be, then you have to use a regulator to regulate the swing as well, okay. Is this okay? From? No, no, there is no separate R here. So, looking back, what you have is when it is on an equivalent of 2Vp in series with R, yeah, and when it is, when the NMOS side is on, it is basically 0 volts in series with R. So, what we were, the circuits that I suggested earlier is to make sure that this R is the right value that you want, okay. The voltage being the right value depends on what you connect here, and that you may need another regulator to drop the voltage. You can also connect it to Vdd, in which case that will be Vdd itself, okay. Is this fine? This sets the signal swing. So, there are two things to control here, the termination resistance and the swing. So, all of these, I mean, at least so far I have shown this inverter like structures. You have a PMOS switch to the top and NMOS switch to the bottom. So, the top voltage rail that defines the signal swing. The size of the NMOS and PMOS or the number of units, etcetera, etcetera, that will decide the, or the overdrive. You have the combination of everything that decides the termination resistance. Now, to accurately control the termination resistance, you can essentially change the size of the devices, which is like having multiple units and connecting an appropriate number in parallel, or the overdrive voltage, okay, either one is possible. That you do through a separate control loop on the side, and relying on matching, you apply the same control to everything, whether it is the number of devices or the overdrive voltage, okay. Any questions so far? Now, for the one of the slight problems is that you use PMOS in the switching path, and PMOS, you know, is slower than NMOS typically. So, for very high speed serial links, this may not be a good thing, but you can't help it. I mean, if you want to switch a high voltage, you have to use PMOS, right? You can't use switch an NMOS. NMOS cannot switch the high side voltages fully. But if the swing is low, you can do that. So, let's say you are looking at 2VP, which is substantially smaller than the supply. Okay. So, let's say it's VDD by 2 or even smaller than that. Then what you can do is, this is the 2VP, which is much smaller than VDD. You can use NMOS for both the high and low side switching. This is what is known as the high side switch, and this is the low side switch. I mean, NMOS can connect this to this, but the gate voltage has to go higher than the drain voltage, right, for it to be in the triode region. Okay. So, that is why it is not possible if the high voltage itself is at VDD, then you cannot take the gate to something higher than VDD, it is more difficult. Okay. With bootstrapping and so on, it is possible, but we are now talking about the gate has to go high and low at the symbol rate. So, that is not possible. Okay. But if this 2VP is let us say smaller than VDD by 2, you may be able to do this. The gate still goes to 0 and VDD. Okay. It is faster. The high side switch will be now faster than if you use a PMOS. That is the idea. To get a given R on from a PMOS, you have to use a wider PMOS transistor that increases the parasitics. Okay. And PMOS switching itself is inherently slower than NMOS. So, that is the reason why if you have both to be NMOS, it is better. But you do have a constraint on the swing. Okay. Now, in this case, first of all, the high, you still have to size these differently. This high side switch has to be sized a little bigger, because if the gate is swinging from let us say 0 to VDD, the source voltage is different. I mean, in this case it is 0. In when the high side switch is on, it will be at some higher voltage. Okay. So, for the same gate voltage, the source voltage is higher, the VGS is different. To get the same R on, you have to size the high side switch to be bigger than the low side switch. Okay. They have to be sized differently. Is this clear? But you may be able to, I mean, because both are NMOS, you may be able to just pick a ratio between the two. You do not have to separately tune them. I mean, that may be possible, because both are NMOS and they track each other. Okay. And then you control only one side, let us say the low side switch with a negative feedback. When I say low side switch, you have a replica low side switch, you control its resistance using the techniques that I described earlier. And you make the high side switch certain percentage bigger than the low side switch, and you can do this, right. And every technique that I described earlier, either using multiple parallel units or controlling the gate voltage, that can be used here also. I mean, it is the same thing, it is just that the higher side switch is also NMOS, that is all. Is it okay? So, again, I am showing the skeleton circuitry. So, you have to add it, I mean, replicate it for the differential side and so on. Okay. I am assuming like differential signaling. So, a voltage mode transmitter, it potentially has power savings. Like I said, theoretically it is 1/4 of the current drive. You will never get that. Okay. Maybe half is a good thing, but it is still not bad. I mean, it is not usually, I mean, usually you do not find techniques that suddenly reduce the current by a factor of 2. So, that is good, but the transmitter circuits are a little more messy in that you have to control things in a different way. Whereas, in a current mode, the MOS transistor inherently is closer to a current source. So, in the current mode transmitter, you have a nice resistive termination and that is it. Whereas, here you have to adjust the MOS size. by transmit voltage I mean this 2 VP which you are sending from the transmitter side, and termination resistance to control the transmit voltage. This needs a voltage regulator. Okay. So, basically the voltage on top rail, voltage on the top rail is not equal to VDD, it may be less than VDD, and you supply that from a regulator depending on the swing that you want. It's also not good to, I mean, just because a larger swing will give you a better SNR at the receiver potentially, but as you go on increasing it, the power dissipation also increases. So, that's why you don't go always with a swing of VDD, okay, you can go with a smaller swing, right. And if you have, if you are limited by crosstalk, it does not help to increase the swing, because I am assuming again a whole bunch of identical channels. So, if your desired signal increases its swing, the crosstalking signal also has a larger swing, right. So, then there is no benefit. I mean, if noise, if it is a fixed noise unrelated to the signal, then increasing the signal will have a benefit, but if it is something like crosstalk that is proportional, then it does not have any benefit. Transmit voltage, you use a regulator, and for the termination resistance, you can control either the size, basically you can't control the size continuously, but with parallel devices, or the overdrive voltage, okay. And for this, like, you need lots of, I mean, basically the regulator also is a DC feedback loop. So, you will use feedback loops for controlling all of these things, okay. Any questions about this? So, voltage mode transmitters are also used, but the main motivation for doing that is lower power consumption, okay. But you need to do a little more work to set the termination resistance correctly. Actually, no, it is not the DC resistance, I mean it is basically the impedance that you would see, right. But I mean you do not have any control over the parasitics except that you can try and make it smaller and smaller, okay. What we set is the DC resistance with these feedback loops, okay. What is DC or AC resistance? It is not the small signal resistance that you look at anyway, okay. We are assuming the transistors are in triode region, and so when they are transmitting. So, let us say the low side driver is on, I mean let me draw a differential driver with NMOS stuff. This is 2 VP, okay. So, this is the output positive of the transmitter, okay. VO plus and this is VO minus, oh sorry, VO minus, and this goes to the channel, okay. I hope you understand what I mean by this. I mean the lower switch is off here, and similarly here the higher switch is off, okay. So, this is a differential transmitter. So, the lower switch is off and the higher switch is off over there. So, this is how it is, and then you terminate this, okay. And if you do this, what happens is you will have 2 VP across this and VP across this and VP across that one. Okay. Now, I am assuming that this VP is small enough that this transistor will actually be in triode region, okay. This will be at VDD and the gate will be at VDD. In reality, this is nonlinear, and frankly, I also do not know what exactly happens if you connect a nonlinear device to the transmission line, but with the feedback loops that we have, what we control is sort of the large signal resistance in this condition, right? That is, let's say I am adjusting the width or the number of devices, okay. What will I do? I will have a DC servo loop. I connect the gate to VDD, okay, and I have a number of devices, and I pass my reference current through this, and I pass my reference current through the external resistor, and I make sure that these two are equal, okay, by controlling the number of devices. And in fact, to mimic the transmitter operation correctly, I should choose the voltage across this. This voltage should be Vp, okay, so that it mimics the behavior it sees in the transmitter, okay. Now, of course, if you do this, I do not know if this is the optimum, but I think this is generally what is done. In this case, what you are ensuring is that your MOS transistor's characteristic ID versus VDS is like this. You are probably operating somewhere here. This is not quite a straight line. So, this is Vp, and you are making sure with this process that this I divided by Vp is the correct conductance, okay. So, that is not the same as the slope here. Hopefully, you are operating well enough in the linear region that it does not matter. But this also means that as the transistor is turning off, the resistance is also changing, I mean turning on and off, okay. That non-linearity is definitely there. So, in case of voltage mode transmitter, I showed it for a single tap without equalization. So, you make another voltage mode transmitter and then you just add it in parallel, okay. I mean, meaning that that part I did not talk about. Essentially, what you do is the equalization is roughly like it is in the current domain. That is, what you do is you connect two of these in parallel, these voltage mode transmitters, and the size of the tap, the size of, let us say, the post cursor tap to the size of the main tap will be the tap ratio that you want. So, it is actually the current ratio that you are adjusting, the current that is coming out of the equalization tap versus the current from the main tap. So, they are just connected in parallel. Ideally, I mean, if you think of everything in the voltage domain, then you should put the taps in series, but that you cannot do anyhow, okay. But then you have to also make sure that the combined resistance due to the tap transistors and the main cursor transistors equals the termination resistance, okay. So, that is why the voltage mode transmitter is a little more messy, its characteristics are not as nice, whereas the current mode transmitter, it does work more or less like the textbook stuff, right. So, when you have multiple taps, you have to add currents, and that is what you do with differential pairs, okay. Good. Any other questions? Okay. So, we will continue from this.